Saints of the Americas is a series that seeks to share information on the life and times of the saints of the Catholic Church celebrated in the Americas. Your program hosts are Father Jim Korda and Father Jack Lavelle.
Hello and welcome to our show. Now we're going to begin by talking about Charles Nerinx. We know he's from Belgium, and he didn't come to the United States until the age of 43. But let's tell the folks a little bit about him and his early life.
Well, as you mentioned, he comes to the United States a little later than some of the other priests and religious that we've spoken about in our series. He does end up in Kentucky, but prior to that, he is a priest in Belgium. Now, around the time that he is living, it's and ministering as a younger priest, it's still the remnants of the French Revolution. The church is still in persecution in France and in Belgium. We're told that for 7 years of his priestly ministry, he was in hiding. And so one of the interesting things is he would hide in the attic during the day so that no one could see him, and then he'd be out in kind of the farmyard and the chicken coop at night, all so that he could continue to minister and to serve, but a lot of it being done in secrecy. We kind of hearken back to the early days of the church itself when it was illegal to be a Christian, and we know a lot of our trappings for Mass are still from the early church celebrating the sacrifice of the Mass on the tombstones in the catacombs and the candlelight that would illuminate their ability to be there. But from this, he continues to remain faithful. We know that he was working in a hospital that was administered by his aunt, who was a Benedictine nun. And then along the way, he is able to escape other difficulties, being arrested, and finally makes his way to Kentucky in the United States.
It's interesting because there's many of the saints that we have talked about on this show that have left their country primarily because of persecution. And obviously, Charles Nerinx was one of them. But he finds a wealthy friend, a wealthy nobleman, who wrote to Bishop Carroll of Baltimore about Father Nerinx and asking if he would invite him to his diocese, which he did. And so at the age of 43, as we had mentioned in the beginning, he leaves Belgium. He boards a ship from Amsterdam to the United States, and he's on this ship for 3 months. And tell us about his voyage.
Well, as he's coming over, we know that along this journey, he considered the ship really kind of like a floating hell. It was very difficult, the conditions and all of that were going on. One of the things that he was hoping for was a better life. But all of this that's going on, one of the things we know is that when he does arrive, one of the needs that he has is he needs to study English. So he comes to this new land, but really not fully prepared for it. It really was, as you said, one of that fleeing. Things were very difficult in Belgium. They weren't great on the ship, but finally he arrives here under the auspices of Bishop Carroll and is seen as somebody who might be able to minister to people here.
It's interesting because as we talk about the United States during these times, we're talking about mission territory. And many of the folks that we will be talking about, the venerables, servants of God, those who are on the way hopefully to sainthood, basically came to the United States as missionaries. And so we see his pastoral care really is a vast area which takes about half of the state of Kentucky. He visits flock on horseback, takes 6 weeks at a time to go from place to place to minister to people. And then we see in 1815 and again in 1820, he goes back to Europe in search for other priests to join him in this mission. And isn't that oftentimes what happens even in religious congregations? Once they set up a congregation here, they'll go back to their homeland to recruit more young people and more religious to come back to serve in their ministry. And so we see that this is happening. Let's talk about, in the last about 4 minutes of our time together, the foundations that he began.
Well, as you mentioned, he does go back and invite others to come. It's worth noting that one of the recruits that he brings back with him is a Father Peter, who becomes one of the most faithful ministers to the Native Americans. As you mentioned, though, he does continue to allow the church to flourish in the foundation of different communities. He founded the Sisters of Loretto, known formerly as the Friends of Mary, at the foot of the cross in 1812. We know that one of the other things that he's really proficient in is procuring religious articles and bringing other items that we might take for granted nowadays, you know, but to really supply the people that he was ministering to with rosaries and with other images of the saints or of the Blessed Mother or the cross itself. So that was a great thing that he worked to achieve, these devotions, because again, you're looking at a church territory, as you said. He's going on horseback from place to place. He wasn't there every Sunday for every one of these congregants. And so there really was a great sense of responsibility on the people that he was imparting the faith to take some responsibility for themselves, to continue to invite those prayers and those devotions into their lives. I think that's something we kind of take for granted or don't understand was part of that growing church in our country. We do know also that he was very interested. His missions would reach out to girls being taught, which was something that was not readily available. Again, ministering to Native Americans, to slaves. And so we really see, as we do with many of these types of men and women on the road to sainthood, a desire to reach out to the most disenfranchised among society.
And we know that ecclesiastically his life takes another turn. We know that in 1808, John Carroll, who was then the Archbishop of Baltimore, recommends Father Nerinx to be appointed Bishop of New Orleans. When the appointment came through, Father Nerinx declined the appointment because he thought that there was too much work for him to do in that vast area of Kentucky. And in 1824, though he asked Bishop Benedict Flagler, who was the Bishop of Bardstown, to permit him to move farther west. And so we see that whole sense of his missionary journey being moved more out into the frontier. So he had a real sense of wanting to minister to the people in those remote areas of the United States. And then in closing, in our final minute, let's share something about his passing.
Well, as you mentioned, this desire to move forward is in the year 1824. So we know that he left Loretto and actually was moving out more into the area that we know now as the state of Missouri. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, he's only there for a few months before illness takes hold and he dies. We know that his body was transported back to the Sisters' Mother House in Loretto 10 years later to be a source of veneration and prayer to the sisters and other visitors to his tomb.
And we just would like to close that Father Nerinx did establish many churches, congregations throughout his missionary journeys, many of which are still in existence today. Stay with us. We'll be back in a moment. The Society of St. Paul announces a new book called Saints of the USA by Brother Marco Bucarelli. This book, for children ages 6 and up, will fascinate young readers as they learn more about the saints of North America. Those who read it will meet 10 figures who have lived lives of holiness, as well as the Immaculate Conception of Mary, patroness of the United States. The book can be found at St. Paul's Books and Gifts, at 926 Boardman Poland Road on Route 224. The store is open Monday through Saturday from 11 a.m. to 6 p.m. or call 330-953-2443 or email at stpaulsbookstore@gmail.com and learn more about these saints of our time.
I am Mary Knoll.
Yo soy Mary Knoll.
Mary Knoll, an American Catholic organization of priests and brothers, has been reaching out to those in need for nearly 100 years in 26 countries throughout the world. Missioners, workers, volunteers, supporters, we are all Mary Knoll.
I'm Father Mike, and I am Mary Knoll.
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 Welcome back to our show. Now we're going to talk about Father Felix de Andreas, born in Italy. Tell us more about him.
Well, he was born in 1778 in northern Italy. As a young man, a desire to be part of religious life, he joins the Vincentians, a community founded by St. Vincent de Paul. Mm-hmm. He was ordained a priest in 1802, and he spent the first 4 years of his priesthood preaching parish missions. We are told, though, that his health starts to fail and his superiors are concerned for his health. So rather than him going from parish to parish to preach, they feel that if he stays in one location, it might be better for his health. With the keen intellect that he had and already having impressed them by his preaching, they assign him to Rome to teach in the seminary. And we know that he teaches there for about 10 more years of his priesthood. While he was preaching, however, a retreat to priests at the seminary, there was a bishop from Louisiana, Bishop DeBorg, who was present for one of his mission presentations, and he was quite captivated with Father Felix and with the knowledge and the wisdom and the spirituality in which he imparted. And he was so taken with him that he wanted him to come with him to Louisiana, to come to the New World and to preach, perhaps to form new priests for the church here in the United States. While that sounds wonderful, his superiors were not as excited at that prospect. They didn't want to let him go. Now, we're told it's a twofold reason. One, they were legitimately concerned for his health. If he couldn't go around and preach in parishes in northern Italy, how would he take a journey to this new world and be in all of this foreign territory? But the other was, they had already established him as someone who was responsible for the education of their priests. It becomes so difficult that a battle brews between the superiors of his order and the Bishop of Louisiana, so much so that it reaches the desk of the Holy Father, if you will. And the Pope himself has to make a decision. And he does decide in favor of Bishop DeBorg. And we know that Father Felix then is able to go to the New World.
We also know that, that the Bishop and Father Andreas and the Vincentian superior signed a contract that stipulated that he would have to recruit more Vincentians to come to the United States with him to engage in this mission style that Father Andreas was really drawn to. And so he did that with the hope of erecting a seminary at the time. And so Father Andreas eventually recruited 13 volunteers. He recruited priests, brothers, and seminarians. And they came with him. And later, one of them was eventually the Bishop of St. Louis and administrator of the New Orleans Diocese. But the recruits left Italy in two groups and met in Bordeaux, where they planned to study French in preparation for going to New Orleans. While they were studying, though, something happened. And what happened then?
Well, their first assignment, as you said, was to go and be in New Orleans. And so, of course, they think that they are going to need to study this French. What happens is they receive a letter from Bishop DeBorg changing their assignment. And as a result of the change in their assignment to St. Louis rather than to New Orleans, these Italian Vincentians now need to study English. And so the ship from Bordeaux to the New World becomes a floating seminary. And they not only learn English, but they learn how to communicate that in terms of scripture and other aspects. We know that there is daily mass on the ship. So it really does become this floating classroom, this floating seminary, to prepare these men as best as possible for their ministry in the New World.
We also know that once they have arrived in Baltimore, their next stop was to be Bardstown, Kentucky. And we know that was one of the four dioceses created initially here in the United States. And then they went overland from Baltimore to Pittsburgh, and then down the Ohio River to Louisville, and then 30 miles to the seminary of St. Thomas in Bardstown. Father Andreas, we know, stayed there a year teaching theology and studying English. But then something happened in 1817 to Father and also some of the priests that were with him.
Well, as you said, they journeyed to these different ministries. One of the people that was with him throughout this time was this Father Rosati, who becomes a bishop himself. What happens is all of this kind of ends in St. Louis in 1817, and almost immediately Bishop DeBourg names Father Felix to become the Vicar General of Upper Louisiana. And while fulfilling those duties, he erects a seminary in Missouri, mm-hmm. and he began the first novitiate of Vincentians here in the United States. So there was no rest from their labors. It was a whole different ministry, but one that he was certainly prepared for.
And I think part of Father Felix's ministry was also reaching out to the African Americans, both free and also those who were slaves, and also to the Native Americans at the time. He also learned the Native American language so he could best communicate with them, and also translated the Our Father so they could pray that together. He also planned to write catechism in their native tongue that would help, but unfortunately he ran out of time and wasn't able to do that. But the Vincentian superior then questioned his health way back before his ministry here to the United States. Why was that providential at the time?
Well, we certainly see that the questions about his health will continue to come into play, and certainly his health was sufficient for a good while. But the stress of missionary work, the stress of creating all of these different, whether it be the seminaries or other parishes that he helped to establish, and the hardships that are part of that, which are described by Father Felix himself, really continue to take its wear on his health. Stomach ailments continued to worsen, we're told, and he dies only 4 years after arriving in the United States. So when you think of all that he accomplished in just 4 years, it is certainly magnificent. But those 4 years certainly took a toll on him. The superiors were providential, and he does end up dying in 1820 here in the United States at the age of 42.
We also would like to mention in closing that Father Felix was a spiritual director to another saint, Saint Rose Philippine Duchesne. And it's interesting when we talk about these venerable or servants of God or people who are already declared saints, that they've had relationships with other holy people. And isn't that what it's all about? Holiness attracts other holiness. And so him sharing advice spiritually with her assisted her in her sainthood journey. And hopefully Father Felix, as we talk about his life and celebrate that he will continue to move towards the journey of sainthood. Stay with us. We'll be back in a moment.
The Society of St. Paul announces a new book on Louis and Zélie Martin, parents of St. Teresa of the Child Jesus. The book focuses on her parents' journey towards sanctity and their family life and social commitments. This book was compiled for couple and group sharing and is meant to strengthen the journey of all in marriage and family life towards sanctity and holiness. The book can be found at St. Paul's Books and Gifts at 926 Boardman Poland Road on Route 224, located across from the Olive Garden Restaurant. The store is open Monday through Saturday from 11 a.m. to 6 p.m. or call 330-953-2443 or email at stpaulsbookstore@gmail.com and learn more about these witnesses of our time.
My name is Sister Mary Claudina, and I run a home for abandoned children. I want to take care of children who have no parents, because luckily I come from a very loving family. There are eight of us. And I remember when one of my cousins got sick, and she called my mom and said, "Mom, the doctor has said that I might not have too long to live. Will you please raise my three children for me?" I remember we had a meeting at home, and my dad called the meeting, and my mom was explaining to all of us. And my father said, you know, this powerful word. He said, "We already have eight. What is three more?" We learn to care for each other, to love each other, to fight among each other, to make up, to forgive, to just to be a family. And I think that's what I learned from home, and I wanted to share that with children who do not have that love and that opportunity just to know what a family is all about.
Welcome back to our show. Now we're going to talk about Pierre Toussaint. Very interesting life. They call him Venerable because he is on the path to being beatified and hopefully canonized. Has a very interesting life. Where did that life begin?
Well, it begins in what we now call Haiti. He was a slave, and we know that he spends a good deal of his time there. He was born in 1766 as a slave, as I mentioned, on a plantation owned by a Frenchman named Jean-Jacques Berard. And he worked as a domestic servant. So it was, there were differentiations among different slaves. And so he was not a field slave. He was in the household. As a result of being a domestic servant, he did learn to read and to write. And we also know that among his interesting talents, even as a slave, he learned to play the violin. And while that might seem very odd, a slave who learned to play the violin, at being a domestic servant in a large plantation, they would have looked to their servants, regardless of whether they were slaves or not, for entertainment, for being able to offer hospitality to their guests. And so there was that need for these different skills, a musical instrument, to read, to write. We know that what happens is that this Monsieur Berard, he foresaw that the Haiti slaves would one day revolt. He is much kinder to his slaves, and it's thought that he decides that he needs to leave the country. He sees that this slave revolt, even as good as he is to his slaves, certainly there's going to be a great uprising in the country. And so we know that he takes a certain number of his slaves, predominantly his domestic servants, and they move to New York. Among them is Pierre.
Now, it's interesting because when we talk about saints, we talk about how they are patrons of certain things. And we have patrons of lost articles, patrons of school children, patrons of so many different things. If and when he is declared a saint, when he is canonized, what will he be patron of and why?
Well, we're told that most certainly he will become the patron saint of hairdressers. And while that might seem odd to some of our viewers, again, as you said, we have patron saints of every activity, every employment, every nationality. And so usually there is some type of connection. The connection is that as Pierre arrives here in the United States, one of the skills that he acquires is to be a hairdresser. He ends up doing hair, and we know that regardless of his position in Haiti as a slave, he becomes someone who moves about the wealthy class in New York City, and he becomes a hairdresser to many wealthy women right here in New York.
Earlier on, you were mentioning about the perhaps the revolt that was going to take place among the slaves in Haiti. We do know that that revolt, which ended in a bloody rebellion, actually took place, and many of the slaves there were freed. And it was in 1801 that this Berard went back to Haiti to see if there was anything left of his own plantation, and sadly enough, there wasn't. But he wrote a letter to his wife saying that everything they owned was lost. And so eventually he dies, and life goes on for those slaves who did move to other places. And of course, when we see Pierre Toussaint coming here to the United States, in particular to New York, there's some interesting things that happen. He's also not just a hairdresser, but he's also someone who reaches out to the poor, to the needy, and his whole concern for charity among the poor is perhaps why he's being elevated to sainthood. What were some of those things that he was involved with?
Well, certainly, and we see that care and that compassion first exhibit itself in a very unique way. And as you mentioned, Monsieur Berard dies, but he does leave a widow. But again, everything they had in Haiti was lost. And so we know that Pierre first uses the income of him doing hair and many of his clients being rather generous. He uses that income to support Monsieur Berard's widow, Madame Berard. Mm-hmm. And we see what an interesting turn that someone who, even though he was treated very well by them, he still was their slave, he still was their servant, but he will not even abandon this woman in her destitution. So he uses his income to kind of prop up his former owner, if you will. And so that then has him move forward. And we see that he really, and she ends up dying of tuberculosis, and he himself then inherits the home that he had helped her maintain and keep. We know that he continued to work as a hairdresser, but as you said, he really wanted to reach out to others. And we know that he found a desire to be close to God. He quoted the Beatitudes often. We know that there was this desire for the imitation of Christ to be part of his life. And so it was really reaching out and offering himself in many ways. We know he eventually marries, and he and his wife adopt his sister's daughter. She sadly also dies at the age of 14 of tuberculosis. But he continues to reach out and ultimately continues to be able to practice his faith in a very public way in St. Peter's Church in New York, and there finds ways to continue his service.
And earlier on, we talked about how holiness attracts holiness. We talked about some of the relationships of saints and how they are advisors or spiritual advisors or friends or missionaries with other ones who accept their mission in charism. And so we know that Pierre Toussaint also worked with St. Elizabeth Ann Seton in reaching out to the poor, especially through the Daughters of Charity, funding needs for the orphans. And so we also know that he reached out to educate African Americans at the time, poor African Americans at the time, and also subsequently sent food and clothing and medical items back to Haiti to support his own people there. There's interesting points about the population in New York City at the time and many of those who found refuge in New York. Let's talk briefly, 1 minute left of our time together, about that.
Well, during his lifetime, later years, the population of New York City decreased by half because of an epidemic of yellow fever. And we know that many people fled, but he remains behind to help nurse victims of the epidemic who cannot leave because they are infected, including bringing a white man with yellow fever into his own home. So again, we see this man who was, from the beginning of his life, a slave, who I'm sure dealt with racism his entire life. He would, again, that imitation of Christ, he saw Christ in everyone, regardless of color, creed, a desire to help and serve and minister all.
And sadly, he dies in 1853. Thank you for being with us. Have a good day, and God be with you.
Saints of the Americas was a production of CTNY, the Catholic Television Network of Youngstown. Your program hosts were Father Jim Korda and Father Jack Lavelle.